Okay, ladies and gentlemen, why don't we come to order? We've got a great evening for you tonight. I think we're going to conclude the fall series of lectures, a trilogy or a hat trick, as we would say in my native land, by focusing tonight on the Mechaber, Rabbi Yosef Karo. And I have been experimenting with trying to reintroduce a little bit of humor into my lecture, so I'll begin with a small joke, which is appropriate, I think, for this audience in particular. The joke goes like this. It's a very famous one. Rabbi Teitelbaum, I'm sure you know this one, because this is really in your bailiwick, but the joke goes like this. There's this 19th century Rebbe who goes from town to town and gives people advice on their various problems, and they ask him shilas and things like that. And when he's wandering with his wagon driver between Minsk and Pinsk, the wagon driver looks kind of dejected. And so the Rebbe says to him, you know, Chaim, what's bothering you? And he says, you know, Rebbe, I feel badly because, you know, I'm sitting up here in the front of the wagon, and it's cold and it's rainy, and I take care of the horses, and I'm doing all this hard stuff. And when we get to the town, you know, nobody offers me a cold drink. Nobody says Shalom Aleichem. They all run to you, and they give you so much kavod. And I know you learned so much Torah, and it's fitting. But, you know, I feel like leftovers, you know. So the Rebbe says, you know, I see where you're coming from, Chaim. So how about this? Before we get into the next town, let's change clothes, and I'll sit up front and drive the wagon, and you be the Rebbe, and we'll come into town, and you'll get some of that Hachnas Zorkim. And he says, that would be great, Rebbe, I really appreciate it. So they do that, they switch clothes, and Chaim is now sitting in the back of the wagon, and he's, you know, stretched out on the chaise lounge, and he's relaxing, his shtreimel is just popped over the front of his head like that. And they come into town, and of course, all the townspeople come crowding around the wagon, and they say, but they don't have the usual expressions of welcome. They say, oh, Rabbi, we're so glad you're here. We are very, very troubled. We have this huge halakhic problem, and we don't know what to do. We're completely paralyzed. This is a problem that has stymied the greatest minds we have, and we don't know what to do. Please, Rebbe, you have to help us. So he says, sure, no problem. So the townspeople lay out the problem for him, and it truly is a brain teaser. And so the Chaim thinks to himself, and he says, you know what? This is actually a very simple shaila. Even my wagon driver could answer this one. Right. So the reason for this joke and the segue to the lecture is, of course, because I feel a little bit like the Rebbe in this lecture. We're going to be speaking about the great Mechaber, an amazing individual who, of course, charted the future of our orthopraxy as Jews to this day. And the real expert in this presentation is really going to be Rabbi Trump, who's going to be leading us through the textual elements of the contribution of the Mechaber. My goal in the first 25 minutes or so of this presentation is just to provide a little bit of a historical background to the life and times of the Mechaber, and set the stage, so to speak, so that all of the really difficult questions can go to the wagon driver, which will be in the second half. Anyone recognize the picture in the background here? Tzvat, very good. So this is a highly educated audience. Please, nobody ask any hard questions. Tzvat is, of course, the place where the Mechaber made his claim to fame, although he really only entered Tzfat when he was an older man, and he had in fact composed most of his greatest works long prior to his arrival. When he arrived in Tzfat, he was considered the elder statesman. He was the first among equals among a very remarkable group of rabbis who had gathered in this northern Israel town, but his life and work really stretched back much further to the Iberian Peninsula, so that's where we're going to begin today. Just a second, I've got to go back one more slide. Here we go. So this is the iconic representation of the Mechaber, which is most likely not at all what he looked like, but at some point someone in the early 20th century probably drew that, and we kind of got fixated on it as an image of him. We call him the Mechaber, literally the author, as a sign of respect. Sfardim tend to call him Maran, our master, or by the name of one of his many famous books, the Beit Yosef, the Shulchan Aruch, occasionally Kesef Mishnah, but not quite as much. We'll refer to him with either of these monikers, but his real name is Rabbi Yosef Ben Ephraim Karo. His years are 1488. That date should be fairly significant. It's 10 years, of course, before the expulsion of the Jews from Spain. And he died at a hoary old age in the year 5775, which, so we just remember his yahrzeit. Obviously, I don't know who types these things, rabbis, you know, but he died in 1575. Sorry about that. Kind of rushing. His main contribution, for those of you who may not have been as familiar with what he did, is he is the author of some very important halakhic commentaries on the pre-existing codes that were a major part of the Jewish intellectual enterprise for the prior half millennium. And he authored the one which would really become definitive for Jewish practice, the Shulchan Aruch, the set table. And so that I'm going to leave most of the details of the discussion of his writings to the second half of this presentation. What is fascinating, however, and I will just give a little bit of an insight into this, is that although one might think that the author of legal texts would be perhaps set in the sort of Weltanschauung of Maimonides, an uber-rationalist with a distaste for the supernatural and a reliance on rational approaches to decision-making, this is actually not the case at all with the Machaber, despite the fact that his work displays a tremendous rigor of thinking and deep commitment to the 13 hermeneutical principles that we read every morning in Shacharis. He actually claimed that his work was recited to him by a heavenly being called a Magid, that he had, as it were, a kind of a lahavdil, a Jewish muse, a supernatural emissary that was inspiring him to follow the halakha and to write it down exactly as we have it. Fascinating kind of combination of the deeply mystical, Kabbalistic approach to non-rational Judaism, I don't say anti-rational, but non-rational, and nevertheless finding its expression in a legal code that we follow to this very day. So, let us place him in his Iberian origins to begin with. And as I mentioned, the times in which he grew to maturity were of exceptional moment in Jewish history. Perhaps one of the most difficult periods that we had endured since the destruction of the temple in the first century. I've been doing actually a lot of reading on this topic lately because in Brooklyn my lecture series has been looking at Sephardic Jews. And I was struck today as I was sort of thinking about what I would speak tonight that there's a reflection in Raoul Hilberg's work. Raoul Hilberg is the founding father of modern Holocaust historiography. He wrote a massive book called The Destruction of European Jews back in the 1960s, three volumes that chronicled the mechanics of the Nazi bureaucracy. He was especially known and sometimes criticized for really delving deep into the Nazi archives and working heavily with German language sources to understand exactly what was the bureaucracy of murder. And in the introduction to his work, he says that it was basically just like the Spanish Inquisition and expulsion. And I always felt, when I read that chapter, I always felt like, you know, come on, isn't that stretching it? We're talking about 500 years difference, very different kind of environment, totally different motivations, you know, and I always was, I was relieved when I got past that chapter into the other materials, which were actually depressing on their own, but for different reasons. But the more I read about the Spanish Inquisition and the expulsion, I actually see the wisdom of Raoul Hilberg's association of those two events. The Inquisition, the persecution of the Jews in the 15th century was so intense and so inexorable and so unavoidable that you feel the same kind of pendulum of doom swinging that you would see in the 1930s in Germany. Also a very similar element, which we can sense even ourselves to this day, is the post-Holocaust generation for at least a century was deeply affected, the post-expulsion century was deeply affected by that moment, just as we, as survivors in one form or another of the Holocaust, and I don't mean to diminish those the actual survivorship, but I mean those of us who are Sheres HaPleita, still Jewish after the Holocaust, we also regard the Holocaust as a tremendously unique seam in time where there is everything before the Holocaust and everything after the Holocaust. So this is the kind of intellectual environment in which he grew to maturity, that this tremendum had occurred and that the world was never going to be the same, and in fact it was not. So let's just look at some of the historical elements. The mechanics of the last few decades of the 15th century were shaped largely by this man, Thomas de Torquemada of Segovia, who was the chief inquisitor to the monarchs Ferdinand and Isabella of Spain. Like the Nazis, Ferdinand and Isabella were slaves to their ideologies, and historians including Bibi Netanyahu's father, who pioneered this field, still argue over whether this was more a religious imposition on the Jews or whether it was a political imposition on the Jews, but there's no question that all historians agree that they were trapped in this way of thinking and they could not budge from it. What was this way of thinking? At the end of the 14th century, in 1391, there was a wave of forced conversions of Spanish Jews to Christianity. This was technically in violation of canon law. The church had repeatedly banned forced conversions of Jews, but once a Jew was converted to Christianity, there was no way back. The church did not have a legal mechanism to recognize someone who had become Christian moving back or reverting back to their religions, even if they were baptized against their will. This occurred once again at the Disputation of Tortosa in 1414, and so you had a population of people in the Iberian Peninsula who were literally anusim. They were converted to Christianity against their will. The way that the Spanish kings and queens, and at this point it was slowly coming into formation as a more unitary political entity, they chose different ways to try to deal with this, basically by resettling those forced converts into separate areas. They designated them, by the way, as new Christians, meaning they were not quite the same status as old Christians. They were Christian, but they had a secondary class, even though they had been baptized. So they were segregated, and eventually they were even expelled from certain regions. What's especially important here is also the fact that many of these so-called new Christians really wanted to be old Jews. They wanted to revert back to Judaism. They were not allowed to under any legal mechanisms, but they continually associated with the Jewish community. And so this created a conundrum for the Spanish leaders that they had to try and protect these so-called new Christians from their erstwhile co-religionists, separating them, segregating them, forbidding any contact with them. They imposed a whole pile of really incredibly cruel punishments on Jews who maintained associations with new Christians, and ultimately this found its expression in the Inquisition itself. The Inquisition was initially dedicated to those new Christians who were Judaizing, meaning they were forced to convert, but they really wanted to be Jewish. And so the Spanish monarchs launched a massive campaign, which piggybacked on a much older church campaign to try and prevent this heresy, but they pursued it with incredible vigor and energy. Torquemada himself was incredibly cruel. In many cities, they were hanging or burning Jews at the auto de fe, like 10 every week. In some cities, you actually have hundreds of Jews burned at the stake for associating with conversos or being conversos themselves and associating back with Jews. There was a whole series of tortures to try and coerce people to explain who they had received their kosher meat from, or were they in fact lighting Shabbos candles, and a ridiculous array of purge-like mechanisms were put in place. This is a famous painting by Goya that depicts conversos being ritually humiliated wearing something called a sambanito. It's like an absurd-looking sort of tunic that they would be forced to wear. In some cases, even when they confessed, if they were allowed to live, especially wealthy ones were allowed to live on pain of penalty, they sometimes were forced to wear this for the rest of their life. This was their designated clothing. They also have this absurd hat, which is related to the Judenhut, the hat that the Fourth Lateran Council of 1215 mandated for Jews to wear. Of course, it later evolves into the dunce cap, which I don't remember from my own childhood, but my father, Olav HaShalom, used to tell me that he often sported a dunce cap in the corner of his classrooms, and it was an embarrassing, humiliating thing. At any rate, the Inquisition morphed from an attack on these conversos, these anusim who were forced to convert to Christianity, into an attack on the entire Jewish population because they were assisting these Jews in their efforts to rejoin the community. And this culminated in the horrific expulsion of 1492, which occurred with quite a shock to the community. There is significant evidence to show that, you know, they really didn't come around to this until quite late in 1492 itself. They gave the Jews only a few months' notice, and they essentially emptied the entire peninsula of Jews, Gesundheit, with the exception of Portugal, which would happen later. Now, this caused a massive diaspora of Sephardic Jews. A significant number of them went into Portugal over here, but their haven there was short-lived. They were only allowed to live there with some safety for 5 years, when under pressure to form a dynastic union, the King of Portugal agreed to expel the Jews who were living there as well. Although it was kind of he didn't want to lose the material benefit of the massive number of Jews who had become refugees there, many of them quite wealthy. Just think for a second, the economic upheaval of removing a wealthy urban element from the peninsula, it was devastating to the Spanish economy. The way that they tried to recoup it was by seizing all Jewish assets and even seizing debts that Christians owned to Jews. The crown claimed them, and so Christians, even after the Jews were expelled, had to pay their debts back, but this time to the crown. And that slowed down the Spanish economy for a few years. It wasn't for about a decade until they began to recover again without the Jews. At any rate, in Portugal, the king said, all right, listen, all Jews have to leave. But I tell you what, you can stay if you convert to Christianity, and as a bonus, I will exempt you from any punishment from the Inquisition for 20 years. In other words, if you want to remain in the country, all you have to do is this silly little baptism thing that we don't take terribly seriously, and we will not examine your private behavior for 20 years. The thinking being that after 2 decades, they would eventually, you know, come around to becoming Christian, but they were not going to look too carefully if Jews decided to remain Jewish and go through a false conversion. But ultimately, in 1497, the Jews, any Jews in Portugal, either converted and were essentially lost to the Jewish people, or became crypto-Jews, which is a phenomenon we won't treat today, but is a fascinating one, or they fled. And so you have this massive diaspora, which included the 10-year-old Mechaber, who probably, we don't have a really good sense of his origins, but he probably did flee from Portugal, not from Spain, so his family originally made the move over here, and then out west. His father died shortly thereafter, and the Mechaber spent much of his time wandering throughout the Ottoman Empire, which was ironically far more friendly to Jews than any Christian environment. The leader of the Ottoman Empire said, in fact, that he laughed at the kings of Spain and Portugal because he was giving Istanbul such a boon in the form of these literate, economically advantaged and skilled populations. And so Jews flooded, in particular, the Peloponnesus region, Thessaloniki in particular, Istanbul here at the Bosporus into the Black Sea, and ultimately into Israel. Three places which the Mechaber himself visited and stayed for some time. So as I mentioned, he was orphaned as an early age. We know some of the influences that that affected him as he was wandering through Turkey in particular. He was present at the burning at the stake of Shlomo Molcho. He was a rather fascinating individual that I would love to have some more time to speak about, but he was essentially an individual who portrayed himself as a Mashiach, as a Jewish Messiah. He was probably somewhat deranged, but or possibly he was inspired. There's a fine line between those things, and he was ultimately burned at the stake by the church. This is, by the way, his rather fancy signature, which proclaimed kind of like a royalty and a proclamation. But he was very moved by the martyrdom of Shlomo Molcho. He also met several Kabbalists while he was in Greece in particular, and he formed an especially close attachment with Shlomo Alkabetz, the author of Lecha Dodi, the father-in-law of the Ramak, the brother-in-law of the Ramak, the Rabbi Moshe Cordovero, and ultimately the grand teacher, as it were, the teacher of the teacher of the great Arizal. So he was very much associated with these, all of whom, by the way, were exiled Sephardi Jews, who were like living as expats in these other countries decades after the expulsion, still lamenting their fate, trying to figure out what it means, and gathering together because they had linguistic affinity in Spanish or in Portuguese, and thinking about messianic thoughts inspired by people like Shlomo Molcho. We know only a little bit about his family life, largely through his own references. He mentions three different fathers-in-law from which we derive that he must have been married three times. We do not know the dispositions of those marriages. Possibly he was a widower two times over. We do know that he buried three of his children during his lifetime, and three of his sons survived him. Other than that, we do not know a lot about his personal family life. His major activity was primarily in his period of wandering. Like many of these greats, Ibn Ezra as well, much of his writing was while he was wandering from place to place. But by the time he settled in Tzfat, which is this rather amazing phenomenon, Tzfat is a city that is, this is actually an entrance to his shul. You see his Beis Maran, the house of our master, of Rabbi Yosef Karo, the Magid. His merit may protect us. The Tzfat was this unusual moment in time where you had an explosion of Jewish creativity that was virtually unparalleled in all of Jewish history. And what is the reason for it? Did I tell anybody the Abramson rule of history? If you don't know the reason, the answer probably is?
Follow the money.
Money, exactly. Thank you. Obviously, this is a graduate student at some highly prestigious school. Tzfat. It's a place that is not mentioned anywhere in Tanakh. It has no Jewish history to speak of in the vast majority of the sources that we have. But the Ottoman Empire, which had recently expanded there, granted tax credits, tax breaks to incipient industries, particularly in textiles. Textiles is a favored field for Jewish merchants, and so a lot of these Spanish and Portuguese Jews were attracted to this place. It happens to be a very beautiful place. It's about 7,000 meters above sea level, and it's got this kind of like special air to it. And the early Kabbalists who gathered there, which included Shlomo Alkabetz and the Ramak, his student, they created essentially a form of spiritual tourism, because what they would do, and I'm not making this up, this is a really amazing thing, they would go on these self-imposed exiles called Gerushin. The Ramak actually recorded a book called Sefer Gerushin. A friend of mine is going to be translating it, God willing. They would just go wandering in the fields and valleys and dales around Tzfat, and they would like suddenly be moved to kind of like mystical inspiration, and they would describe those inspirations and saying they were moved to like recite a particular parak of Tehillim, or they would meditate there for several hours. They would receive these insights, and later they associated these places, possibly with some historical antecedents, sometimes not, with grave sites of major figures from the Talmud. And so the rumors that these great Kabbalists were doing these things attracted more Kabbalists to come there, including the Arizal, who came from Egypt to be able to study at the feet of the Ramak and Rav Yosef Karo and others. And it created a nucleus of Jewish spiritual activity that lasted just about seven decades, and then it was all over. There was a series of earthquakes and plagues, and it just never regained the same kind of spiritual energy that it had in the 15th century. But this is ultimately where Rabbi Yosef Karo retired, and it was way more active than Boca Raton. It was incredibly active with great minds. If you can imagine, in this tiny little village, you have crowded in there all of these Nobel Prize winners. That there's the Ramak, the Al-Sheikh, the Rav Yosef Karo, the Arizal. It's overwhelming. And there's a whole story that I think will take us a little bit too far afield to really explore. But there was a discussion led by a man named Rabbi Yaakov Beirav to actually take advantage of the gathering of such great minds and reinstitute smicha that had really lapsed sometime in the ancient period, and to try and declare that the rabbis who were present in Tzfat would in fact be able to begin a new smicha movement. Again, it'll take us far beyond our field to explore that particular experiment, which ultimately did not come to fruition. These are some of the graves of the great Kabbalists there, clothed in this blue, which is associated with a warding off of the evil eye. And here is the grave of the Mechaber himself with a tzedakah box on it for visitors. So this is just intended to give you a vorspeise to the real meal, which is going to be an exploration of what exactly did he write, why were his contributions so signal to Jewish culture and life. And for that, I'm going to turn it over to the wagon driver, Rabbi Trump. Thank you for your attention.
So first of all, just Birshus Rabbi Talabam, who has really led this series with Dr. Abramson to its beautiful conclusion right now. This is something which is as a chus that our shul has the opportunity to host, to be able to learn both the context and the content of what makes such a big difference in Jewish history. I'd like to really it's just so fascinating to be able to hear the historical point. Let's try to dive right into content itself. Now we're at the end of a very fascinating series, because what we've done up till now is we've learned a little bit about the Rif and the Rambam, very, very much, the development of halacha till the crowning glory of Rav Yosef Karo, the Mechaber, the author himself. What I want to do is really to explore a model, and then to look at that model in an example, of to see what it was that he did and how beautifully he did it. What we're going to do is the following, is that we're going to do a development of halacha, a brief development, which touches on what we've been doing over the last few weeks, but just to see where Rav Yosef Karo fits into this bigger picture. And we will hopefully explore a specific example to see how his writings actually reflected this itself. We're going to start at Sinai. Sinai, of course, the year 2448 from creation, was the year in which Hashem endowed humanity, us, small biological scraps of material, with meaning by giving us the Torah and saying, when you do things, this matters. But the interesting thing is that Hashem gave it to us in two forms. Hashem gave us both the Torah Shebichsav and the Torah Shebal Peh. At this crowning moment at Sinai, we were endowed with two aspects of Torah. The first one, of course, the Torah Shebichsav, is the written Torah itself, initially in the form of the Luchos, and later on in the Torah Shebichsav, the written scrolls that we have. And there's a debate as to whether the whole Torah was written and given at the end of the Sinai experience, the desert experience, or whether it was written in sections and put together at the end of the 40 years so that we could have it in one piece or in sections. But nonetheless, the Torah Shebichsav and anything which was added to the canon, the 24 books of Tanakh, Torah, Nevi'im, and Ksuvim, is included in the divinely inspired writings of the prophets and of Moses. This becomes the Torah Shebichsav, the written Torah. What most people forget is the other side of the equation. That is the Torah Sheba'al Peh, the oral Torah. Now, this is a bit of a hazy area for most of us, because it's very hard. There's a lot in here. In fact, the way the Rambam divides it, he divides it in his introduction to the Mishnah and in Hilchos Mamrim into either three or five sections. On a more basic level, on three sections, he basically says that there are three parts of the Torah Sheba'al Peh, that which is given. There is the accompanying tradition as to explain what was written in the Torah. So when the Torah says Pri Eitz Hadar, when it talks about this fruit, The oral tradition tells us that fruit is the citron, not the mango, not the banana, not the apple. It just means the citron. So we know that. It wasn't a matter of debate. It wasn't a matter of deriving. It was what it was, and we transmitted that from year to year, and that's why there's no community in the world that shakes the mango. That's section number one of Torah Shebaal Peh. Section number two of Torah Shebaal Peh is, in fact, is what is called the tools of expansion, which means God gave us what we call the Yud Gimel Midos, the 13 principles that Rabbi Yishmael talks about, where we're able to, it's the sort of the toolbox to expand the concepts beyond here. It's not just making the camp with what we had, it's taking the raw resources, using certain logical tools to expand the Torah Shebaal Peh even further. That's another a separate section which is done over the stages of later Jewish history. And finally, the last section is what's called Gezeros and Siyagim. Sort of, you know, the perimeter fences to protect the Torah Shebichsav. All of these things were incorporated in the Oral Torah. Written Torah and the Oral Torah both given at Sinai. And this is how it was for centuries. For centuries we had the written Torah was all we had written, and with the exception of a few notes here, a few notes there, there were no volumes, there were no books. It was all orally transmitted. Until many years later, when we reached the times of the Mishnah and the Gemara. The Gemara tells us in Gittin that unfortunately around the time of the destruction of the Beis HaMikdash, in the years ensuing, following the Hadrianic persecutions, the Bar Kokhba revolt, there was a real fear. This is about the time that the Smicha was being obliterated. There was a real fear that this would be lost. This transmission from generation to generation, from father to son, from mother to daughter, this was going to, at this point in time, completely be lost if something wasn't done drastically. And the Gemara records, they had to commit it into writing. So they did so under the tutelage and the power of a man by the name of Yehuda HaNasi, who had not only just the financial wherewithal, but also had the political wherewithal to be able to gather all the sages in Israel together to be able to write down the Mishnah in the form of the six Sfarim, in the six sections, what is now known as Shas. Shisha Sedarim, the six sections, which are Zroim, about agriculture, Moed, which are about the festivals, Nashim, relationships, Nizikim, when it comes to damages, Kodshim, referring to Korbanos, and that which goes around that entire Rosh Tumah and Tara laws, all of the Torah Shebaal Peh was essentially canonized into these six different sections. But it was constructed in a very fascinating way. And as we know, for anybody who's learnt Mishnah and Gemara, it is not exceedingly easy. And part of the reason is because it is what's called inductive learning, as opposed to deductive learning. Inductive learning is, so like the in Lahavdil, when you talk about mathematical induction, so if you have a series which says 2 and 2, 4, 6, we know by induction that the next number is 8, because we can induce the formula is n plus 2. It means whatever it is, plus 2 is the next one in the formula. We haven't been told the rule, but we can induce the rule from the series that we've been given. The Mishnayos, in a certain sense, were constructed in a way that we weren't just getting the information. We needed more. We needed to induce the rules. We needed a Rebbe. We needed the transmission still to be able to unlock that rule. And in a different way of looking at the way I try to describe it, is for those who are not from the Southern Hemisphere, anybody who's trying to study how to play cricket, as an example. Don't know if Dr. Abramson counts in this regard. But if anybody wants to learn how to play cricket, so one way of learning the way to play cricket is you open up the Encyclopedia Britannica and you read what it is. Another way of doing it is you watch a cricket match and you hear the commentator talking about, you know, that was hit for a six, we're past the third slip, you know, on the way back the batter just missed getting into the crease before the bails were knocked off, and you're all foreign language. But slowly you piece together when you see the conversation about the experience, you work out the rules for the experiencer. So it was constructed in a way which is very much the conversation about it, which we have to work backwards to get to, back to what the rules are. That's because it's part of the educational way in which we get the rules. It's not just a textbook. This is very important because this is where the Mechaber, this is where the Rav Yosef Karo is going to be so instrumental in this work. A few years later, 300 years later, the process was still under such threat that the following conversations about the Mishnah in these six silos was still at loss of being lost. And under the guidance and the redaction of Rav Ashi and Rav Vina, to the later fifth generation Amoraim, sages of the Gemara, they took those writings and those conversations about each Mishnah, and they formulated the Gemara, the Talmud, into 36 volumes, which are on most of the Masechtos of Shas in those six in the six silos. And this became, of course, the canon in a certain sense. Once it was closed, there was no more Gomorrah. There were commentators on the Gomorrah, but this is it. Now, the reason why this is important is, where does halacha go from here? We have the Torah Shebichsav, which is what's called in Chazal Kvir V'Kaima. It's in one corner, it is not to be changed. Then you have the Torah Shebaal Peh, which was oral, transmitted, and then transmitted in a more expanded, written way. Very hard to access, but that's part of the educational way that we maintain. And what happens afterwards? So we see, over the generations, what we call the codifiers on the page. The people who are the halakhic experts, who started taking this work and turning it into halakhic rulings, but on the page of the Gemara itself, in the same format as the Gemara, as was discussed just in this series. Rabbi Yosef Karo, well, we'll start actually the other way around, apparently. Let's do it this way. Rabbi Yosef Karo Fassi, which was discussed, so we're not going to go back. Obviously, Rabbi Talabam and Dr. Abramson talked about this a couple periods ago. Rabbi Yosef Karo Fassi, who wrote the halachic commentary at the back of the Gemara, essentially omitting anything which wasn't presently halachically relevant at this point in time. We also see later on the works of Rabbeinu Asher, a very fascinating personality, a person who bridged the Ashkenaz world and the Sephard world. He was actually exiled from Germany upon persecution of his Rebbe, the Maharam of Rottenburg, who was imprisoned and ransomed, died in prison, in fact. When he saw the writing on the wall, they knew they were coming for him. He took a trip down, went through southern France, and ended up, in fact, if I'm not mistaken, in Toledo, which was still at a good time, was still in the golden age of the Spanish Jewry at this point in time, and spent time with the Rashba, one of the greats of the Spanish Jewry, very fascinating person. And what he did a similar thing. He wrote a commentary essentially on the Rif, Rabbi Yosef Karo Fassi, commentaries on the halachic commentators of Gomorrah, but he didn't change the format of the Gomorrah. He changed the same, it was the same rubric, it was the same halacha, it was the same Gomorrah, he did not change, in a certain sense, the headings or the way it was formatted. He simply codified what was there in the way it was. So if you wanted to learn about Pesach, you'd have to go to the Gomorrah in Psachim. You wanted to find out about the Seder, you'd have to go to the 10th chapter of Psachim, Arve Psachim, work through all the sugyas over there, and then distill it into the halachic rulings at the end. And that became where we'd find halacha up till now. Of course, the revolution of halacha entered when we started to meet people who codified by topic rather than by page. And of course, the heading this revolution was none other than Rambam, who was discussed the last time. The Rambam's incredibly unique contribution was the Rambam took essentially all, and this is all just a repetition, he took the 14 topics of all Jewish halakhic thought, and he basically started the process again. He said, I'm going to tell you halacha from square one all the way onwards into 14 categories. Everything in halacha. And when you go to his kever, you can see the beautiful fountains which go through 14 marble pillars, each with the name of one of the books of halakhic categorization, which the Rambam has. There on the right are some of the four of those 14. Into the books of the Rambam, what we call Mishnah Torah, which is the repetition of Torah. What was revolutionary about this, as was discussed, but now we're getting to the why it's meaty for us, is that essentially was the first person to do this. No, nobody else was moving away to create a new system, a new table of contents for halacha up till now. And he did it very logically, and there were subsections and subsections. Everything was clearly annotated and in place. This is what a typical page in the Rambam looks like, as we know. And what's going to be important for us is not so much the Rambam right now, but the right-hand corner. This is all the outside column, essentially. This is where the spine is on the left-hand side here, is the works of the Kesef Mishnah, which is going to be Rav Yosef Karo. Because one of the first and most important works, as we see, of the Rav Yosef Karo is going to be his commentary on the Rambam. Moving in this direction at the same time, another person who contributed to this new, well, called the reformatting of halacha, was a person by the name of Rav Yaakov ben Asher. We know him in a more familiar setting as the Baal HaTurim. You know, when we always hear those gematrias, and you know that and everything. So we say, oh, that's a Baal HaTurim. The Baal HaTurim did write gematrias on the Torah, and he talked about lots of numeric coding in the Torah, but that was by far paled in comparison to what he really did. Those are very relevant and wonderful to read, but what is his significant contribution to all of Jewish history is a set of books called the Arba Turim, the four columns, essentially. What he did was, he said, as opposed to the Rambam, he said, let's take all of halacha and put all of contemporary halacha to the exclusion of Beis HaMikdash, to the exclusion of laws which pertain to Eretz Yisrael and the mitzvos hatluyos ba'aretz necessarily, to exclude certain things which relate to Tumah and Tahara. Things which are not relevant to us, he excluded, like his father, who was in fact Rabbeinu Asher. the person who wrote the commentary on the Gemara, the halakhic commentary. And instead what he did is he set up these four sections, what he called Orach Chaim, the way of life, which was about ritual life, Evan Ha'ezer, which was about relationships, Yoredeh, which were more ritual, relates to Nida, Avelus, Shchita, Ta'aroves, Basav Echolav, and then finally, of course, Choshe Mishmat, business law. Those are the four sections of all halakha. What's fascinating to us, of course, is if this is a page of Tur, where the Tur, Rabbeinu Yaakov is writing his commentary in the middle, of course, the important commentary we're going to look at over here is on the right-hand column, which is the Beis Yosef, also Rav Yosef Karo. It is fascinating that Rav Yosef Karo was the commentator on two of the newest formattings of halacha. This lays the stage for where Rav Yosef Karo enters. Rav Yosef Karo started off by looking at the people who wrote halacha in the new format, in a certain sense, in their own reconstructed format, and linked it back to the page. Because there was a great rift that was happening, and in fact you see this in the writings, there were part of the burnings of the Rambam, there were many reasons for burning the Rambam, but was the newness of this. Is how do you have the right to leave out the sources and reformat halacha in a way which we've never seen beforehand? So what one of the works the Beis Yosef did, what the Rav Yosef Karo did, was to say, let's take what we have, the Gemara, and let's find how it leads into and connects to these new formats, these new silos of halacha, whether it be the 14 books of the Rambam or the four books of the Torah. So this is, in a certain sense, the background to what Rav Karo was trying to do. I want to take a simple example just to make this a more real to us as we see it played through. So an example, just a very simple example. Washing hands, Netilas Yodayim. Okay, as an example, if it's all right, I apologize. I think I sent out all the sources. If I could just grab one, that's all right. Thank you. Thank you so much. What we're going to do is we're going to do exactly that movement. There's the four steps that we had up till now. We're going to move through the Torah Shebaal Peh as codified in the Gemara, through the Rambam and the commentary of Rav Yosef Karo on the Rambam, through the Torah and Rav Yosef Karo's commentary on the Torah, and moving into finally the grand crowning glory of his career is his writing of the Shulchan Aruch, ultimately to see what he was really trying to do. See, here we go. Very, very, very simple section. The Gemara says the following. This is the Gemara to be found in Talmud Bavli in Brachos. It is in the source sheets as well. This is a very short line. The Gemara says the following. To Omar Rav Chia Bar Ashi, Omar Rav. Rav Chia Bar Ashi says in the name of Rav. Techifos mina shalosh techifos hein. There are three times one has to do something immediately, meaning there's two activities which need to be proximate to one another. Teichef l'smicha shchita. When a person is about to shecht an animal, they need to do smicha, put their hands on top of it. That needs to precede the process of shchita immediately. Teichef l'geula tfila, something which we do every morning, is that we need to finish the last bracha of the Kriyas Shema, which ends with Baruch Atah Hashem Goal Yisrael, and immediately afterwards jump into the Shemona Esrei, even avoiding saying the word Amen. And finally, Teikef L'Tilas Yodayim Bracha. And immediately after washing our hands, we need to do a bracha. These are the three techifos. These are the three things Jews need to do right away, besides for booking a hall and a date and the new email address, right? So this is what the Gemara tells us. Now, it happens to be, interestingly enough, that it's a little bit ambiguous over here, because what does that last statement mean? It says that we need to be very quick to go from washing hands into a bracha. Well, what does that mean? What exactly are we referring to over here? A little bit of a gray territory, because we have a few options as to what that can mean. So for this, we move straight into the first level of codification off the page. And that's the Rambam. The Rambam says very clearly over here, if we move into the way the Rambam codifies this halacha. So again, the Rambam is now extracting a halacha to be found in Meseches Brachos into his own category, which is Hilchos Tefillah. He says, I'm going to talk about Tefillah. There's going to be one book about prayer. In prayer, I'm going to tell you how you're going to wash your hands, how you're going to say your brachos, and how you're going to daven. Here's how he explains it. Tzorich Adam L'nagev es yadav v'achakach yochal. A person needs to dry their hands after washing and then eat. However, v'kola oichel b'loy niguv yadayim k'oichel lechem tome. A person should make sure to dry their hands off so they shouldn't be eating impurely. V'kola nertov yadav v'achron amenagev achakach mevarech. When you wash your hands after the meal, what do we call the washing after the meal? We call that mayim acharonim, the later waters. There's the mayim rishonim, the first waters, and there's the mayim acharonim, the later waters. When you do those last waters, he says, the takeif netilas yodayim birkas hamazon. When you do those netilas, that, 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 that last netilah, that last washing of the mayim achronim, the later waters, as the meal is finishing up, immediately after you do that, you need to make sure to whip out your bensha and start saying the berakas hamazon and the blessing of grace at the end of meals. That's what the Rambam is saying. He is essentially interpreting that Gemara. He is saying when the Gemara talks about washing and bracha, what washing is it? It's the washing following the meal, and which bracha is it? The bracha following the meal. That's what the Rambam has done and has codified for us. He doesn't tell us where, if we look through this Rambam, the Rambam doesn't tell us where he got this from. The Rambam doesn't tell us his sources. The Rambam is just telling us. Now, if we were well-versed in all of Talmud, we would know that. But if you're reading the Rambam for the first time, this is the first time one would meet this. So in lieu of that, the commentary on the outer column of the Rambam is in fact the Kesef Mishnah, the first work of Rav Yosef Karo. He wrote it, the name of it, of course, of Kesef is the silver of the Mishnah. Why Mishnah? Because the name of the book of the Rambam is the Mishnah Torah, the repetition of the Torah. So this is the silver of the repetition. So it's sort of like the adornments of the Mishnah. What is he trying to achieve with this? So let's take an example. What's the first thing that the Rav Yosef Karo is doing in this event? He says, "V'takef nantilas yodayim." He says, "B'perak keitzad mevarchim meimer derochia bar ashi amar Rav." So the first thing that Rav Yosef Karo does is he gives the source which the Rambam omitted. The Rambam never footnoted his works, the Rambam never explained where he was getting it from. The Rambam, in his absolute brilliance, was distilling all of the Oral Torah into these categories. The first thing that Rav Yosef Karo does for us is says, see here, click, right? The first thing he does is, this is the Gemara, where it comes from. That's step number one. He goes on. If we're going to skip a few lines after the source, he says, Umashma midiri Rabbeinu, the Rashi, based on our master's teaching, the Rambam's teaching and Rashi, Delahafsik bediru ben maim achronim levrocha mutar. He points out that it seems like you're allowed to speak between the last waters and benching, rather vatam shaloi pirish takef lenetzilas yodayim brocha shaloi yafsik benehem. Afilo bediru mishu, and so he goes on to explain that the only hefsek, the only break, which is a real break, is eating. Not speaking. Speaking is fine until you actually lift up and pour the cup for Birkas HaMazon, but it is eating which is going to be the problem. So what the Beis Yosef, or the Kesef Mishnah, Rav Yosef Karo is doing in this particular situation, is he's given us the source and a little bit of an expansion, a little bit of a nuance in the way the Rambam is reading it, to exclude talking as being a break in this particular instance. Okay, this is what he has contributed to the explaining of the Rambam. And he writes this for all the books of the Rambam. Let's go a little further. Now we move on to and the next generation. A century later, the Tur, Rabbeinu Yaakov, is now codifying halacha. He is to be found in Hilchos Betzia Sapas. That's the halachas pertaining to the meal. Everything in Judaism is prescribed and regulated. So here we're talking about the meal. And here is what he says. He goes on to give us a very clear description. V'yenagev yodav heitevi varech birkas ha-moatzim yad. He says a person should wash their hands and immediately say amotzi. He says, however, mi rabenu yoel kosav she'en lochush al hapsak hefsek ben netila la amotzi. Kevon sha'ashulchon lefonav v'dato le'echol lo'echoshiv hesach adas. So somebody called Rabbeinu Yoel says, you don't have to worry too much if you wash your hands netilas yodayim at the beginning of the meal and then say something to somebody else and sit down and eat. Why? Because the table's there, the food's there, your mind's on the food, you're about to get to the meal. That's not considered a break. Don't worry so much about the break between the first netila, the first washing and the meal. The only time you need to worry about it is the second washing and the last bracha. Do you see there's a little bit of ambiguity as to what the Gemara really meant? Did it mean that the washing and the birkas hamotzi at the beginning of the meal, or the birka, or the netilas yodayim at the end of the meal, and the birkas hamazon? Rabbeinu Yoel felt there was no problem making a break at the beginning of the meal, and he quotes as well, he says the following, he says, V'chein pirush Rav Alfas, and so says Rav Alfazi, that's the riff, Va Rambam Zal, and the Rambam as you saw it. However, V'adoini Ovi Harosh, my father, my teacher, my master, the Rosh, Rabbeinu Asher, Zichron Livracha, quoting his father, Hoya Rogil Af Berishonim Shola Lahafsik Vishola Ledaber. He said, my father was very careful to only speak in ums. No, that's not what he meant. My father was very careful not to communicate at all once washing hands and then eating the meal. at the beginning, which is the practice that we have today, right? We don't make we don't speak, we don't do anything else between washing and having hamotzi. In fact, he had a trick. When he would sit down to asurim acherim, that he would be the last person to wash. As I like to say to my guests, you know, there's an ancient Chinese saying that he who washes first speaks least. Right, when it comes to washing. So what the Rosh would do was he would make sure to be the last person in the line, so that his break between washing and saying the bracha on hamotzi wouldn't be in fact very minimal. We're seeing an interesting thing over here. What's emerging in this halakhic work of the tour is that there's a debate. Is there no breaks at the end of the meal and the washing in the end of the last bracha, or is there no breaks at the beginning of the meal between the Netilas Yodayim and the hamotzi? A debate. The fascinating thing about the tour is, as much as the tour is in a certain sense coalesced all of halakhic liturgy up to this point into one place, he very rarely ruled on it. He never tells us what to do. Isn't it interesting? He quotes the Rambam at the beginning. He quotes the contemporary, the Rosh, the later contemporary of the Rambam, the Rosh later on, and he leaves it. And the tour does this very often. Sometimes he will rule and say what he believes and lean in on the in the discussion. But very often, as over here, what happens is he leaves it hanging, which leaves space over here for those commenting on the Torah to say, well, what do we do? Bottom line, what do we do in this situation? We understand there's two opinions, there's an ambiguity in the Gemara, what do we do? Bottom line, Rabbi. So this is what happens. The Beis Yosef, who is now Rabbi Yosef Karo, not commenting on the Rambam, but commenting on the Torah, does a very similar thing. We're not going to read it all inside for the sake of time, but Rabbi Yosef Karo does exactly the same thing. He says, well, you want to know where he gets this from? It comes from that Gemara in Brachos. You want to know, you know those opinions that he talked about, the Rif and the Rambam and the Rosh? Those are the people he was commenting on. Well, here's where they're found. This is what they say, and he quotes them in full extent. So the first thing he does is, like his commentary on the Rambam, he sources everything. Where does it come from? In a certain sense, he's the bridge between the page of Gemara and the new construction of Halacha under the Torah. And then he does something which is very important. He goes on to describe other people who say this. He quotes, in fact, a Yerushalmi, which seems to indicate that if a person doesn't speak between Netilas Yodayim and saying Amotzi at the beginning of the meal, they're going to have a good meal, which seems to suggest, like one of the sides, and he says the following, V'chein nachon la'asos lihizayir gam b'mayim rishonim. The Beis Yosef, in his humble commentary on the Torah, says, I'm going to put my card on the table. And he says, I believe that it's true that you shouldn't make an interruption between the Mayim Achronim, the last waters, and the Berakas HaMazon, but you should also not be speaking at the beginning, like the Rosh says. So he is actually now weighing in on that particular Machloikas and adds a few extra details at the end, which we're not going to cover, about the Seder and our Netilos at the night of Pesach. Which now leads us to the last and final stage, which is the Shulchan Aruch. To appreciate the Shulchan Aruch, we need to appreciate the journey along which the Rav Yosef Karo has moved. He has explained the sources of all the Rambam. He has contextualized the entire tour, all four volumes of it, which now turns into the many, many volumes we have at the back of the shul right now, because of his commentary, which has expanded way beyond the short paragraphs that the tour had. And finally, after all is said and done, the most remarkable sefer which has changed all of Jewish history is the Shulchan Aruch. What does he do in the Shulchan Aruch? Here's what he does. This is now Rabbi Yosef Karo talking in the same format, in the same schema as the Torah. He uses the same four books, the Or HaChaim, the Even HaEzer, Yoredeya Even HaEzer, B'Ochosh HaMishpat, but now he shortens it to a statement which is the following. In this particular section, Yesh Omrim, there are those who say, She'enot tzorich lihizayir milafsik ben nitzila lamotzi. There are those who are saying that we don't have to be so concerned about making a break between our first Netilas Yodayim in a meal and saying Hamotzi. V'yesh omrim she'tzorich lihizayir. And there are those who say that one should be careful. In one short sentence, he has summarized centuries of scholarship. And if we had read the Torah and the Rambam and the Beis Yosef and the Kesef Mishnah, we know exactly who he's talking about now. And we know exactly who he's referring to. And then he gives us v'tov lihizayir. And in two words, he tells us, you should be careful. What is commonplace at all of our meals today is as a function of the fact that he said, v'tov lihizayir. This is the way we're going to do things. Ladies and gentlemen, we've decided halacha is this way. He says you shouldn't wait a span that it takes to walk more than 22 amos, 22 cubits unnecessarily. What the Shulchan Aruch has done over here is he has distilled a history into a very simple, into a unified psak, into a unified direction of learning. This is a simple example of that process of formation of halacha to what we have today. Of course, after the Shulchan Aruch, we're going to have blossoming of scholarship, of centuries of scholarship, exploring the Shulchan Aruch himself. But nonetheless, this became the format. It's almost like this is the bottom of that funnel of halacha, which has been distilled throughout the centuries into one coherent psak, taking into consideration, with deference, both sides of the debate, but actually telling us what to do. That's where the Shulchan Aruch comes into. Simple example of what he did over the centuries. What a remarkable contribution to Jewish history. We're not going to focus on all of it. I want to just focus on one thing that Dr. Abramson mentioned, and that is the Maggid. The Shulchan Aruch wrote other Svarim as well, the numerous other Svarim. One of them is what is called the Maggid Meisharim, right? The Maggid literally means the teller. And he describes in this book, as Dr. Abramson had mentioned, that he had nightly encounters with some sort of specter, some sort of angel that he related to, which is again the unusualness of a person of such broad halakhic scholarship, who doesn't mention this at all in his halakhic work, has a completely different description when he talks about his nightly encounters. It's a very fascinating sefer. He writes it very personally. He talks about the personal wanderings that he has and the questions he broaches with this angel that he asks him on a nightly basis and the conversations they had. Very, very fascinating. It's actually written, it's formatted on two cycles of the Torah. So he talks about the Torah and various Svarim in Tanakh by Rabbi Yosef Karo. In fact, if you go for a walking tour in Tzfat today, they can show you the house where he used to stay when he was visited by the Maggid, and every step, every stone in Tzfat has a special history to it, and this is very much, you know, in this milieu. What is fascinating is he describes at the beginning of the Sefer of how he merited to have this angel join him. And the angel sort of came and visited him and then stopped visiting him. And then when the angel came back to him, he said, well, how can I ensure that there's a continuity of this relationship? And the angel said, you're very involved in halacha. You're very involved in the codification process, the end result of halacha. Don't forget Mishnah. Don't forget to keep learning Mishnah, which means keep going back to the page. So coming back to the conversation. Don't lose track of the end result and thereby lose the context in the Torah Shabbat Peh from which that came. That's how you're going to ensure a relationship with me, said the angel. Just a very fascinating reconnection over here. And in this, just as an example, this is a section, a very short section that he has about his Kabbalistic metaphysical wanderings that he broaches one particular subject. He talks about death as an example, just to give you a sense of like just the broadness of what was going on. He has one particular conversation just as an example. Bilal Shishi on Chofei Teves, so he's talking about, he says, Chalamti, I had a dream, Shoya Doresh Esalech Lifnei Hashem Ba'aretz HaChayim. I was thinking about a particular pasuk, I'll walk in front of Hashem in the land of the living. Yeah, and we say, as we say in Hallel, Yakar Beinei Hashem Amavsal HaChasidav. It is precious, or it is hard for Hashem, it is weighty to Hashem, the death of those who are His Chasidim, His pious. Kolamar Mishum Dekosh Beinei Hashem Misas Chasidav. He says it is hard for Hashem when those who are righteous die. Da Paredas Anefesh Me'aguf Domi Lemafrid Dover Shu Dovek BeYoser Im Chavero. He says, death is so difficult, it is sort of stripping two interconnected pieces of one entity. Dugmas mafshit or me'abos. It's almost like trying to take skin off meat, because the two are really one entity. Therefore, he says, demihai salik imhayach, umehayach salik imhai. Mishumhachi mai ovid hakodesh b'ruchu. What does Hashem do? Machvi le'tfei mi'igraihu tuvo, ki'echid ba'ahu chavivuso tistalik nafshayu. He sort of reveals even more of the schar that is going to be shown to them, that there's this automatic magnetic connection that the soul returns to HaKadosh Baruch Hu, v'tisdabek le'elo, and it automatically, magnetically returns to its creator, v'tisparid me'gufa belit sar. And there's no pain in that experience, because the neshama is returning to its source in this way. V'zeu dugmas misas neshikon. That's how Moshe Rabbeinu and Aaron, in fact, died. Komo she'omar b'sefer ha-zohar, b'raza doloi nafko, nishmaso adehi chazye l'shechinta. That the soul doesn't leave until it sees the divine presence among it. Komo da'avdi.